your attention, please.
Yo, yo. You ready for this? Coming at you from Wicked Big Studios in Peabody, Massachusetts.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Sit back, buckle up, because you're in the happy hour with your boy,
What is up, everybody, and welcome back to the happy hour. Guys, I'm so amped up to be here tonight, and I appreciate everybody who's here listening live on the happy hour socialclub.com and the happy hour SC on Twitch TV. Guys, I'll tell you what, I am stoked. We're going to talk. We got a great guest for you today. Just want to let everybody know real quick, we're being brought to you tonight by our friends at Hydro Revolution Fitness. Yes, Hydro Revolution Fitness. I'll tell you what, we'll be talking a little fitness tonight with one of the absolute inventors of the fitness industry. But should you need to get your like me, when I'm rehabbing this ankle, I'm going to be in the pool doing a little bit of rehab with hydrorevolutionfitness.com. promo code King Hap will save you 15% site wide. Guys, GSP and your boy King Hap are the ones to let you know you got to get over there. Use promo code King Hap, save 15%. One other thing, guys, we're also being brought to you today by our friends at the Chicken Pound. Yes, the chickenpound.com. promo code King Hap will save you 10% over there, guys. The best chicken you can buy for easy meal prep. I'll tell you what. Last night, I had some teriyaki chicken tenders. I threw a little bit of Brussels sprouts in the container. Boom. I was all prepped up, and I'll tell you, it went down very delicious. Thank God, though, I got the heavyweight, and I used promo code KINGHAP. Save 10%. Boom. Guys, so let me just, but before I even get going, guys, I'll tell you what, anybody who knows me knows, I mean, I've been a certified personal trainer for a number of years. Also, I'm a Dolce Diet certified coach, and I eat, I sleep, I breathe all kinds of things about the fitness industry. I love my mixed martial arts. You guys know that with over nine clad martial arts in Wilmington, Massachusetts. We got the fight team and all the guys coming on the show. But tonight, I got the man who authored this book, ladies and gentlemen, The Three Muscleteers, The Story of Gold's Gym, The Birth of an Industry, and how a fitness culture was reshaped worldwide. Now, here's the thing, right? I want you guys to do me a favor and give a big, hello to my boy, Ed Connors. Ed, thank you so much for coming on the show, brother. So good to have you, man. And I'll tell you what, in my opinion, absolutely fitness industry legend, pal. Thank you so much for coming on the show, big man.
I'm glad to be here. I'm a big fan of Happy Hours, so your show is well named.
I appreciate that. Hey, to help you have a social club, VIP for life, Ed Connors is. Ed, I'll tell you, man, there's a lot of good things going on in the world and the world of Ed Connors right now. I mean, we got the new book out. It's been out about a month, just about right now. And I'll tell you what, I mean, I got the book, and I know a lot of other people do. A lot of people are saying, wow. And one thing that must be absolutely tugging at your heartstrings is a lot of the people that you were really good to nowadays are saying, wow, you got to get this book. This man helped change my life. Lots and lots of people are absolutely saying, this man is a genius in the industry, etc. And I know you're very humble, but a lot of celebrities, bodybuilders. I mean, I'm at the Mr. Olympia every year, and I'll tell you what, everybody there, you don't walk down a hallway without seeing a Gold's Gym shirt. I know you've been out of it since 2004, but you tell me, big man, I mean, you must be very proud of the brand you built that's known worldwide.
I'm very proud of it. Thank you. It was 43 years ago that Grymkowski and Tim Kimber and I bought Gold's Gym and grew it from one gym to 704 before we exited. So I'm really proud of that. And now there are 680 Gold's Gyms worldwide, 400 overseas. We have over 100 in Japan and 100 in India. So the brand is worldwide, and it's a lot to rejoice in.
And one of the other things that a lot of, I don't know if people do know this, but let's talk a little pump and iron real quick. I mean, you want to talk about blowing up. I mean, Arnold Schwarzenegger is basically the movie that, in my opinion, put bodybuilding on the map. I have watched it, I'd have to say 200 times. Pump and Iron, Gold's Gym and Pump and Iron, that was the thing. Arnold Schwarzenegger had to come from overseas to get a good workout, and he knew where to go. Is that correct?
Well, you make a very good point. Imagine Arnold Schwarzenegger had to go from Graz, Austria, the second largest city, to Venice, California to get a workout in 1968. That's how how rare gyms were. There were no, now it's, you know, in every mile in urban America, you can find a half dozen choices. But back then there was either the hardcore gyms on one end, which were, you know, typically kind of dirty and unfriendly. And then you had the spas on the other end, which were almost a joke. Yeah. So this is what I wanted to write about in my book, The Evolution of Gold's Gym and the Change of the Fitness Industry. But what you point out is very true, because back when Arnold came over, body, you know, weightlifting was not accepted for the three major sports, basketball, baseball, and football. They didn't do it. They thought it was bad for you.
They are opposed to it, right? I mean, a lot of the trainers and stuff back then were like, oh, stay away from the weights. You know what I mean? And you'd see the guys who look like your local butcher was a professional athlete back then, right?
Right. No, and for the women, it was, they thought maybe they pick up a weight, they're going to turn into a man. I mean, it was really, it was almost ridiculous. I mean,
and Gold's Gym's actually what kind of, turn the clock on that, because ladies, in my opinion, and I mean, you tell me, ladies bodybuilding basically was given birth to at Gold's Gym. I mean, that's where women started getting, you know, started getting very toned, very fit. And that's where they actually start. I mean, that was before there was a Miss Olympia and the physique and all this. Now they go ahead and women bodybuilders have a place to go. And you, like you said, there was the old dingy, dirty private gyms that people, it was, you know, you were nervous to walk into. And then you had the ritzy upscale kind of, like, you know, you had to, like, you know, take your shoes off at the door type of gyms. And I mean, what Gold's Gym did was you brought those both together. Hardcore gym meets super duper Euro spa, right? I mean, that's what you were going for.
We wanted to be fitness for everybody. In fact, we held the first women's bodybuilding contest in 1979. And we actually mandated that our gyms be co-ed, which was sort of breakthrough. Back in the day, it was Monday, Wednesday, and Friday were men, Tuesday, Thursday, women, Saturday was co-ed, and Sunday the gym was closed. So we actually had, you know, in the South, we had a lot of cross burning literally in front of our gyms for having co-ed facilities. But people thought women were gonna get raped in the gym, but we never had any problems.
Yep. Well, you think you put a lot of big testosterone fueled athletes in one room, and then you add in, you know, some delightfully fit women, you know, you're going to see, there's a good chance, especially back then, some people might get a little handsy, et cetera. But Gold's Gym, always a classy establishment. I mean, I started at a private gym called Oasis, which was more of the Chinese food type of gym. I think that might be a quote I stole from Ed Connors, you know, it's like Chinese food. The worse they look, the better they are, right? That's a quote I stole from Ed Connors. But I'll tell you what, that's where I started. Then I moved to Gold's Gym in Everett, Massachusetts. And, you know, that's where I got a lot of my body, you know, well, my weightlifting, exercise, et cetera, in. I mean, you went ahead and basically opened that door for people to come from it, you know, basically get to the gym, sweat, smell, leave. Now it was like, it was kind of like a fitness adventure. They'd go there. You could do cardio, which you were the first. I mean, maybe not the first, but you guys basically were the biggest gym to ever put TVs with cardiovascular equipment. Am I wrong?
No, you're right. I don't know that we were the first, but we when I bought the Gold's Gym in Santa Monica with my two partners, there wasn't even a bike in the gym. There was no cardio. And I saw that activity, you know, along the beach in Venice, people riding their bikes. And I thought, well, we should bring that indoors. And Mike Mentzer, Ray Mentzer, two top bodybuilders back then were big exponents of bike riding. So we brought bikes into the gym and we put them up high so you could look down at the gym floor and sort of be entertained. But when we finally moved into the fourth room in our Venice facility, you couldn't see into the gym, so I bought a big TV to put in front of the bikes. So we didn't call it a cardio theater. It was basically bikes in front of a big TV.
So instead of being bikes in front of a wall, which, I mean, if anything could make cardio worse, it'd be staring at a wall the whole time, right, Ed? I mean, you got to say.
Well, nowadays, of course, the bikes have TVs on them, and it's a whole new world. But yeah, back then, that was breakthrough for sure. Yeah, well, now, you know, the typical gym might have over 100 pieces of cardio of some form.
Yeah, I mean, I've been lucky. I travel the world a lot with the show, etc. And, you know, I'm all over the place. I see a lot of really nice gyms. I see a lot of really bad gyms, too. But at the same time, you know, they all the newer equipment that I do lay my eyes on, some of this, right, Ed? And, you know, there are a lot of people in the industry that say, you know, some people say that even, you know, the weight machines are better than the free weights, which wasn't really popular to say back in the day. But some of the things, like I heard Nick Trigili actually said it from Bodybuilding and BS. He said to me, I mean, he said on the show that, you know, basically you're getting perfect form on some of these machines. So some of those old school machines, I mean, that were featured at your place, especially back in the day, Hammer Strength, one of my favorite machines. I mean, is there a better machine out there than a Hammer Strength machine?
I think we helped make Hammer Strength what it is, because initially, I don't think the equipment companies understood the value of having their equipment in Gold's Gym Venice and being photographed in the magazines. But I mean, I think we made Hammer Strength an overnight sensation pretty much, because people would come from all over and see the equipment. So yeah, when we sold, we ended up, we had probably $2 million worth of free equipment, but it was definitely, they got a lot of benefit from that.
I mean, one ad in, like, back in the day in the old school, like, you know, muscle, like the Joita magazines, and, you know, as it kept going, Flex magazine. I mean, if you took out an ad in those things, you're paying big money. But I'll tell you what, you put a piece of equipment in, you know, Gold's Gym Venice, and then here comes XYZ bodybuilder, you know, good friend of yours, Jay Cutler. Actually, I did some work with Cutler Nutrition, and I'll tell you, they, you know, you go there and they take these pictures of Jay, and he's there on the Hammer Strength machine. Guess who's you know, getting free publicity just from giving you a piece of equipment? Right. I mean, you filled the gym like that, right?
Right, we did. We know we had a lot of different brands. Pete, Tim, and I didn't really believe one equipment company makes it all. And you need to have a variety. And for instance, I think the Hammer Strength appeals to people who are taller, typically. It fits them better. So, no, we had probably half a dozen major lines and a lot of different cardio, and it all worked out. And exposed, you know, a full page ad in one of Weider's magazines back then, in color on a month basis, was $35,000.
Damn.
But you could pick up the magazine and not only see the equipment, but you could probably see a dozen or two pages shot in Gold's Gym with athletes, not only with our logo in the background, but also wearing the clothing. We were a clothing company for the first 10 years. We were, you know, that was our main source of income.
Right, really. I know in the book it states that you guys, the first year in business, you weren't necessarily profitable. Just the first year in business, right? I mean, you yourself were worried. You made an enormous, enormous investment. I mean, by the standards of today, I mean, an enormous investment. I mean, your initial investment in Gold's Gym is rumored to be $15,000, huh?
That was my personal investment, yes. I had saved $15,000 to buy a new BMW, fortunately. So I had the money available. So when Pete Grymkowski called me up and said, you want to buy Gold's Gym, you know, I assumed there'd be a lot of other shareholders, but it was just me and Pete and ultimately Tim Kimber.
Yep. Tim Kimber was the third Muscleteer, right?
Right. Yeah. They were two bodybuilders. I'm an architect, and I was an overweight kid who joined a gym to lose weight for the Army.
Now, and here's, I was just going to touch on that. I was going to touch on the, but I had another question. You said, you talked about being an architect. I wanted to throw a funny stat out that I read, is that you tried in your days as an architect to be published in an Italian architecture magazine. Is this correct, or is this rumor? You tell me. And you build buildings in New York and LA, et cetera. And then it took Gold's Gym to get you in the damn magazine. Is that true?
That is very true. I was shocked when I picked up an Italian architecture magazine and they had a feature on Gold's Gym, which, I mean, it's almost comical, because I wouldn't recommend Gold's Gym Venice, the design, for anyone in America. I hate to say crude, but, you know, it was basic. We moved on a shoestring, and, you know, it wasn't fancy, but it did the job, and it's lasted 40 years. Yep. 41 years. Of course, we had a few remodels with the locker room, but no, it's amazing. Our biggest luck was we started with the first bay of a 4-bay warehouse. Over 9 years, we could expand from 9,000 square feet to 26,000 square feet.
And that was over four expansions, correct?
Right.
And one last thing about, I got to ask you about your architecture career. Now, the building that you made was actually the last building in Die Hard. Is that correct?
It was the first. It was the first building in the first Die Hard.
Yeah, but it was like the last one in Die Hard, right? In
I had finished it, and I was senior designer in 1985, and that was my last project that I worked on. And it was, the building was empty, so it got basically used for the movie, for the first Die Hard movie. So it's kind of everybody's favorite Christmas movie.
Oh man, I hear about that all the time. Oh, is it a Christmas movie? No. Is it a Christmas movie? Yes. Oh man, I don't even want to get the chat room going about that. I'll tell you, I'm having a blast. And there's a lot of more things we got to touch on. We're going to take a really brief break, guys. We're going to be right back with Ed Connors. Guys, the name of the book is The Three Muscleteers. I mean, come on. How the hell do you not want to pick this up and read it? Get it over on Amazon. If you guys haven't picked it up yet, it's going to be in the show notes. Ant's going to put it in the chat room tonight, but it'll be in the show notes on every... if you listen to this audio. If not, if you're on YouTube, happyhoursocialclub.com, you can catch the link right in there. And I'll tell you what, we're going to be back right after this brief message. Guys, we got the man who transcended the fitness industry right here with us, the Gold's Gym. I mean, basically one of the creators of Gold's Gym as a franchise. Ed Connors is here. We're going to take this brief break. We'll be back after this.
It's a top selector.
Hey guys, today's episode of the Happy Hour is brought to you by Liquid IV. Liquid IV is the world's greatest hydration drink, and the best part is, it's good for you. Liquid IV is taking care of the Happy Hour Social Club members with 25% off. Guys, that is a great deal. Promo code KINGHAP will save you 25%. They have great all-new flavors like guava, apple pie, watermelon, pina colada, strawberry, and the new Happy Hour-inspired tangerine. All these flavors are refreshing and delicious. Promo code KINGHAP will save you 25%. And speaking of refreshing and delicious, back to your host of the Happy Hour, KINGHAP.
Oh, yeah. I'll tell you guys. Liquid IV got a new flavor coming out, about to hit. I'm not even privy to it. I'll tell you what, I'm one of their spokespeople. Be ready, because I'm going to announce it right here at the Happy Hour. And I'll tell you what, when I do, be ready to get over to liquidiv.com. Use promo code KINGHAP and save a whopping 25%. Liquidiv.com, promo code KINGHAP. I'll tell you. We're back with Ed Connors, and I'll tell you, he's an architect, basically an entrepreneur, and now an author. And I'll tell you, the reason, one of the things is, this book came all together, and you polished it off during the pandemic. Is that correct?
That's exactly correct.
And I'll tell you, you had plenty of time to write, it was an unfortunate time for Gold's Gym. You're already out of the gym industry, but tough breaks for Gold's Gym is after you sold and the pandemic hit, they had to file for bankruptcy protection. Still some Gold's Gyms out there, like you said, a lot internationally as well, but that was very sad, a very sad time for the fitness industry. But I did hear that there's a fitness industry mogul out there that's trying to come up with an idea moving forward for like a post-pandemic type gym. Did you hear such a rumor?
I probably started it. Thank you, Mike. No, I am working on a new gym prototype that would, I think, help the people that are still fearful of going into a gym.
Yeah.
But you're right. The pandemic killed, 30% of the gyms in America are closed permanently. And I think that number may go as high as 50%.
And you know what? Like I said, even the ones that are still open, Ed, they're struggling to recover and stay open and pay their people and pay their rent. And a lot of people don't know this, but a lot of people, get their equipment in and then make payments on it. I mean, you were lucky enough where you, like you said, it's, you know, $35,000 to get one ad, or you could probably get 12 if you give Ed Connors some free equipment to put in the gym over there with him and his buddies. But I mean, in the end, right now is a tough time to be a gym owner. I mean, it's an industry that I love, but one that is definitely in serious trouble right now, right?
I would advise anyone getting into it to go with, it's almost back to the future. I think if you're going to do a gym now, you've got to go back to a gym that's somewhere between 2,000 and 10,000 square feet. Yep. You can't afford a big box gym like exists, you know, in America right now. It's 25 to 35,000, or, you know, some go over 100,000 square feet. There aren't enough people going back to make that model work.
One of the questions from the chat room wants to know, what do you think about the like the CrossFit trainers and the cross training gyms? I mean, you think these gyms are like here to stay? I mean, how do you feel about the? Go ahead, Ed. I'm sorry to interrupt you.
I'm sorry to interrupt you. I think they've hurt a lot of people, and they scare people off. I don't think they're a good thing. I mean, they made a lot of chiropractors a lot of money. That's all I can say.
Yeah, and you know, I know a lot of people who've been injured at CrossFit, and it's unfortunate. I mean, the thing is like, and here's what it is: they're trying to get like a cult type thing going, yeah. Which is nice, because I can tell you, when you first started Gold's out in Venice, that was kind of a cult thing. It was like everybody went there, and right. Everything around Gold's Gym Venice was like bodybuilding, you know, clothing, you know, protein drink, this supplement store here. And basically you could walk up and down right around where your gym was, and it was transcended into a neighborhood of fitness, you know, fitness equipment, et cetera, right? I mean, that must have been a great time to be a fitness enthusiast in Venice Beach, California, correct?
You've really hit on it, because it was an incredible, I mean, everyone calls it magical, but when we first moved the gym down there in 1981, that zip code had the highest murder rate of any zip code in America. That's how bad it was. Venice had really gone downhill. So we transformed the neighborhood. You're probably familiar with the Firehouse Restaurant, but that didn't open up until 4 years after we moved into the area, but we made it safe. But yep. You're right, it was a whole culture, but it was very welcoming. You know, LA is a place where people come with dreams. And so it's kind of like, well, if that person makes it, maybe there's hope for me. So there's a lot of positive energy, which doesn't exist, I don't think, anywhere else in the world, frankly.
Yep. And I'll tell you, I was down there. I went by just to see it. Thankfully, I had the opportunity just to go by, check it out, because I'm a huge bodybuilding fan. Been a Mr. Olympia VIP for about a decade now. I'm there every year. Hopefully this year I'll bump into you out there, Ed. You are going to be taking in the Mr. Olympia next year?
I will be there probably selling books. So
that's what I was going to say.
We got to meet up and do a happy hour.
Definitely. I love it. And I'll tell you what, Ed, that sounds fantastic. I'm a little disappointed in the Mr. Olympia, though. I don't like the fact that they changed it over till December now. I mean, how do you feel about that? In my opinion, Vegas in December is a bad idea. They used to do it in September, and the weather was beautiful, and it brought more people. Now they're doing it a week before Christmas. That's a tough time to have a complete, you know, expo and competition out there where people got to travel for a week's time. No,
I completely agree. I don't understand the timing. When I was part of Gold's Gym, we would have our annual convention almost every year in Las Vegas during the summer. Yeah. And that was a great time for gym owners to get away, because it was typically slow, at least in the Midwest. So it's kind of a strange time, but I'm glad to see it back in Las Vegas versus Orlando.
Yeah, I actually didn't attend any of the ones in Orlando, because, you know, I wasn't exactly sure about all the COVID things and the things were going on. I was nervous about it. I take care of, I have family members that live with me that are disabled, 100% U.S., Vietnam War veteran, disabled. But here's the question, man. Yourself, you were a Vietnam War veteran for about 21 months, if my memory serves me right. Is that correct?
You've got a great memory. I was there for 21 months, and somehow I survived. People ask me what it's like, and I said, well, if you live through it, it's a big plus.
Yep. And I'll tell you, some of the best people I know are, military veterans. So I want to take 1 minute, just thank them, all them for their service. Thank you for your service as well, Ed, because it's people like you that, you know, make this world great. And, you know, all the rest of our people, I know Jacko USMC in the chat room right now. And it's people like you guys that make this, you know, a great country to be part of. So I thank you for that, big man.
Well, I think we're seeing with the Russian invasion of Ukraine that it takes the special military to win. And I think the U.S. has always had that.
Yep. And Pocket Pool says Ed could definitely beat King Hap in arm wrestling. I think so. I think Ed got me in that one. You're right. And he definitely could take out Taco, my co-host on Wednesday nights, for sure. So here's basically, I got a question I got to ask you now. So here goes. Now, one of the things is that you started this whole, you know, did you ever think that Gold's Gym, when you started the whole franchise mode and they started popping up? I mean, at one point, I think you had 704 locations. You were in 26 countries, 46 states in the U.S. First off, what the hell were the other four states thinking? And no one wanted to buy one and put them in those four states? Come on, get with it.
And, well, have you been to North Dakota?
Well, I'll tell you what, at least it'd be something to do in North Dakota if they had a Gold's Gym, right? I mean, right. That's what I'm talking about. But here's my question to you. When you're doing all this, did you ever think about bringing this company public?
Actually, that was my goal during the, when 24 Hour Fitness and TSI on the East Coast, New York Sports Club, started buying up our gyms, I tried to get a group of owners together to go public. I worked on it for 4.5 years, but the timing wasn't right. And of course, getting that many entrepreneurs together to do something was not easy. Yep. And actually, when we sold the first time to Brockway Moran and Partners in Boca Raton, I was hoping that they would take the company public 5 years later, because I think it's a natural. But no, that was my goal. And who knows, maybe it will yet happen.
Yeah, I got a question from the chat room I want to ask you. It just said, have you ever told any bodybuilders they should or should not use performance-enhancing drugs? I mean, it runs rampant in the bodybuilding industry, but is this something that you ever advised for or against, or is this something that, you know, I mean, a lot of times until just recently, a lot of the hardcore bodybuilders and everything zip the lip. It's not, you know, it's kind of like wrestling, you know what I mean? You don't ask, don't tell.
I never advise anybody to take steroids or not take them.
Yep.
Because it was their decision. And I knew many people who really did not want to go that route and still have had amazing careers in the fitness industry. And others, you know, I'm definitely at the end there, I would advise people against taking too much.
Yes, definitely.
And I had an idea about how much was necessary because I had seen so many people. Especially, you know, when they live in your house, I had three houses in Venice at one point, that you can't hide, you know, what you're doing. So, no, I would not support people basically abusing that, but I consider steroids a victimless drug. And I honestly, after 45 years around this, I can't say that I know anyone whose death was caused by steroids.
Yeah, and you know, here's another thing I was going to say. So they're talking, this has been, it leads me to my question. This has been a tough year for bodybuilding. And I, one, am a huge fan of bodybuilding. I mean, I've had tremendous conversations with Cedric McMillan, Sean Roden, The Bull. These guys were awesome people. And every time I met them, I mean, it wasn't like, I walk up, shoot the, hey, how you know, we just shoot the breeze. Cedric McMillan made a funny comment about the woman I was with, you know, we had a fun time, couple giggles and stuff. But it's been a tough year for bodybuilders, and a lot of the pro bodybuilders, another gentleman you were close with a couple of years ago, Big Country, Dallas McCava, I mean, that was very very sad passing. Now with the way this is going, I mean, there's been rumors that, you know, the vaccine with the anabolic steroids causes blood clots, etc. I don't know about that. I'm not a doctor. I don't pretend to be. But my question to you is, I mean, do you think some of the designer drugs and some of the like manufactured things that people are taking, is that the issue? Because we know, you know, you people that are on a little bit of testosterone. I mean, I know Jay Campbell was on the show a little while back, and he says, you know, basically, if you're not on testosterone, you're not optimizing your life. I mean, obviously, you don't need to be on 30,000 milligrams a week, but you know, if you're on 200 milligrams a week or something like that, that's how you can optimize your body, etc. I mean, Do you think that it's the manufactured stuff, or do you think that this is just a bad set of circumstances?
It's both, in my opinion. In other words, I write in my book that I do believe growth hormone has been abused.
Yes.
And I could well believe, and again, I'm not, I'm just speculating here. You know, you brought up Cedric McMillan, really great guy. My guess is he probably had an enlarged heart from too much growth hormone. That's caused quite a number of people I know. But one thing that has hurt, killed people for sure, and I know this from doctors, is synthol. I know at least a half a dozen people who died from that, where you inject fluid into your body to make the muscle look bigger. The doctor told me, he said, Ed, you cannot inject impure fluids in your body and not expect trouble.
Yep.
So that's a no-no. But that didn't exist during what people are calling the golden age of bodybuilding, nor did growth hormone wasn't really in much use. But we've got anti-aging clinics all over the country right now that are basically giving people testosterone and small doses of growth hormone, which the body loses over time. So it's just a natural replacement.
Yep.
But I think like the Ultimate Warrior, who was a house guest, somebody I got into wrestling, I learned when I did an A&E special on him last January or a year ago, January, that he died, his father and grandfather died in their 50s. He died in his 50s. I mean, there's a lot of genetics at work.
That was really sad with the Ultimate Warrior too. He was inducted into the Hall of Fame. The next night he made his triumphant return to Monday Night Raw. Yeah. He went out there, he went pretty crazy out there, but then he had an unfortunate heart attack, which was hereditary and in his family, the heart disease. I mean, I'm not saying that, basically, I'm not saying that, the steroids and stuff didn't have any effect on him. Yeah, but, right. I mean, like you said, his family had a lot of deaths at an early age due to heart problems, et cetera. I mean, that, it's not helped with it, but I don't think steroids was necessarily the lone cause for the Ultimate Warrior. I mean, would you agree with me on that?
I couldn't agree more. I mean, if you knew him like I did, or maybe you got glimpses of him, I mean, what you saw in public was what he was like in private. He was intense.
Yeah.
I mean, here's a guy so intense about his his creation, himself. I mean, he had his name legally changed to Warrior. I mean, that's
and I like that. That was, I love the fact that he had his name changed to Warrior. And one of the reasons is because he didn't own the rights to the name, the Ultimate Warrior. There's another gentleman right now out there. His name's Ryback Reeves. He actually a partial sponsor to the show. Feed Me More Nutrition, guys. Promo code King Hap saves 15%.
He was a great bodybuilder. I knew him well.
Ryback?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a big boy, I'll tell you. Yeah. And he's another person, very intense. But he changed his name to Ryback Reeves because Vince McMahon owned the name Ryback, and when he was a wrestler, that's pretty crazy too. I mean, funny way to circumvent the law, no, Ed?
Right. Yeah. McMahon's when Jim Hellwig, Ultimate Warrior, was younger, he was known as the Dingo Warrior.
Yes.
He wanted to get a free pair of Dingo boots. But so McMahon, who's marketing genius, changed it to Ultimate Warrior. But I forget Ryback's original name. I think it wasn't Michael
Ryan Reeves.
Ryan Reeves.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you.
He's very nice, and I'm one of the first people to ever set up a sponsorship on the Happy Hour, so I appreciate that. And guys, promo code King Hap still works over at get over there to Feed Me More Nutrition, guys. They've gone actually mostly plant-based now, so you guys, that's they're working more towards health than they are for any kind of crazy results. So yeah, if your health's in mind, Feed Me More Nutrition.com, promo code King Hap.
Mike, you make a good point though about the supplement world, because back in the early days when Hellwig was wrestling, he took a blender on the road, because what was in the on the label wasn't necessarily what was in the can. It Yes. didn't taste good. It didn't mix well. Now you can take a shaker and get a great drink out of it, whatever. But back then he had to make these concoctions, to supplement his food. So the whole supplement world has changed, where the over-the-counter stuff is pretty darn incredible. So there are a lot of people out there who I do truly believe are natural. They're just, John Cena, to my knowledge, other than when he was injured, never touched any performance-enhancing drugs.
Yep. And One of the other things is, like you said, John Cena was he was a big pro. He was a big fan of Gold's Gym. A lot of people were. Jay Cutler, you know, was. I mean, a lot of the wrestlers come down there. You had a lot of house guests, you know. And one of the things with your house guests were, they actually brought a lot of eyes onto the to Gold's Gym, which made you guys bigger and bigger. But at the same time, a lot of people wanted to come down there. A lot of people wanted to be involved with you and Gold's Gym. I mean, this place was a factory of, I mean, good people, celebrities, bodybuilders, wrestlers, etc. Right?
Right. It was a magical place. Everybody doing their own thing. Everybody, you know, supporting each other. I mean, it was wonderful. I mean, the actors, actresses were just, you know, one of the gang down there, and people would come out from all over the world.
Yep. And one of your buddies there, I mean, one of the biggest bodybuilders ever to touch the stage, Gunther, right? I mean, Gunther was enormous, and he competed against, I mean, probably the greatest bodybuilder of all time, you'd have to say, Ronnie Coleman, and then obviously Jay Cutler. I mean, those are two of the most celebrated, bodybuilders in the world. Gunther competed against them, and he was as big, if not bigger, right?
I convinced Gunther to come to move to L.A. from New Jersey. And he got a Weider contract and learned English. He stayed in my place with his wife, his first wife, for about 5 months and learned English. That was a big problem with the foreign bodybuilders. Most of them did not speak English.
Yep. And you're right. And you know what else I was thinking too? As these, you know, all those bodybuilders come back then, social media wasn't a thing. Right, yeah. So you could actually get in there, get a good workout. No one's spying on you, posting your pictures and stuff. Right. So people used to get a little crazy at the gym, which was nice. I used to love those days. Nowadays, things are very different. Jay Cutler's actually somebody who brought that to the forefront. I mean, Jay Cutler's a friend of yours, and I mean, now you put bodybuilding with social media. The one thing about that you must not like, though, is that it doesn't give the bodybuilder or anybody else any privacy to go ahead and make these gains or go ahead and bulk to get bigger. And then, you know, then cut the weight because they're like, oh, my God, look at, Ed Connors and King Hap. They're getting fat. No, we're trying to bulk to get bigger. You know what I'm saying? It takes the privacy out of the game. That must be tough, no?
I think a lot of the bodybuilders, frankly, are overexposing themselves. They're posting too much. I don't think they put enough thought into what they're doing.
Yes.
I mean, that's what's so different. Back then, the magazines were the social media. And, you know, you could be on a photo of a bodybuilding magazine. That was priceless and made your career. But nowadays, they're posting pictures, every day too often, not thinking about what they're doing. You can stay at home and create your own self on screen. But I think these guys need to take more care with what they're doing, what they're posting, what they're saying online.
I got a funny question I got to throw to you. Now, I know that, so like we said, social media is one thing and, you know, locations across the world, but that actually helps the bodybuilders make money now and, you know, they can monetize. And before it was only like, if you got a sponsorship, you got a cover of, Weider magazine or Muscle Fitness, etc. Now that gives them a way to go ahead and make some money, which is good. Also shows like mine, books like yours, we can promote online with a lot of, you know, really great people. Happy Hour Social Club, always helping out. But I mean, little do these people know that this gym that all these people are getting big at, and this gym that, you know, everybody travels from all over the world to come to, was actually started because you didn't like humidity. Is that true? I mean, is this true? You started Gold's Gym in Venice because we didn't like humidity?
Well, you're actually right. You really picked up on that in my book. I went down to Orlando after I got laid off work as an architect in New York. I went to Orlando to interview with Disney for the start of Epcot back in 1975. But the humidity reminded me so much of Vietnam. I said to myself, I don't care what they offer me, I'm not taking the job. And I had just been to Los Angeles to interview there for being a senior designer, project designer for the new Neiman Marcus store in Beverly Hills. So I took the job. And while I was in Orlando, though, I met Pete Grymkowski, who was the biggest human being I'd ever seen. And I said, I just came from LA and I saw Gold's Gym. You belong out there. And I told him, if I take that job, which is likely, I'll get you out there and you can, you know, enter Weider's Mr. World and we'll go from there. And he took me up on my offer. He stayed with me for a bit and won Mr. World and then called me to buy Gold's Gym. So it was a It was humidity in Florida and a fluke meeting. It's life is, I think life is half 50% luck and 50% what you do with it, persistence and taking advantage of the luck you have.
Yep. Another question from the chat room. I mean, this is a good one. You were the person that helped Gunther link up and start his career, and he introduced him to Joe Weider. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Wow, that's awesome. I actually didn't know that. That's fantastic. And Tony Duckett, who's actually a VIP in the chat room, I can already tell he's picking this book up. A lot of people are really excited to get this book in. And I'll tell you, you probably didn't know how many people were actually such a big fan of Gold's Gym and all, and, you know, basically the industry. I mean, you must be seeing a lot of great people coming around now. And if you are at Mr. Olympia, I'm sure a lot of people would love to come out and meet you, get a signed copy of the book and bring that home with him, right? I mean, maybe we'll be lucky enough you'll be out there selling books.
I hope so. No, I really want to meet people from that era. I mean, yeah, people have very fond memories of that time, like you visiting the Mecca and, you know, staying a week or two in Venice. And when I met Gunther, he was living in New Jersey and was about ready to go back to Germany.
Yep.
And I said, well, don't give up. I knew Weider would like his look. You know, it would, in fact, the people of Weiderland used to joke that Joe probably wished there were 13 months in the year so he could put Arnold on every cover. I mean, not Arnold, but Gunther on every cover. Arnold was on most covers of anybody. But yeah, Gunther would sell magazines. Joe would show me the sales every month on the newsstand sales, who sold and who didn't.
I do miss those magazines, right? I mean, yeah. I'd have to say Jay Cutler's probably one of the biggest sellers. Ronnie Coleman was probably one of the biggest sellers, and Arnold's probably number one. That's just me guessing. I mean, in your opinion, what do you think?
Arnold, Joe would show me every cover with Arnold sold the best.
That's awesome. And, you know, a lot of the people we talked about come from Massachusetts, John Cena, Jay Cutler. I mean, there's many of them. One of the people that I know.
Paul DeMeo. Yeah.
And one of the other people, Mike Matarazzo, who, very unfortunate. I actually had the pleasure of meeting him back in the day, back at Gold's Gym in Everett. He had his unfortunate passing. I mean, a lot of times I wanted to, you know, people wonder, and this was something that was asked in the chat room as well, if the steroid and things like that, like if this is reversible. But he was another person. He had issues with pain and medication, if my memory serves me correct. But I mean,
he was married 5 times. I mean, that, what does that say, right?
Yeah, well, glutton for punishment. That's that tells me, you know. Geez.
I mean, no, but think of the stress. He was really high strung, and God knows what really killed him. But I don't think it was steroids, frankly.
Yeah, and you know, that was very sad in my area. I know I believe he actually died on my birthday. It was the day he died. I can remember that. It was my birthday, and someone told me that he had passed. I was actually pretty shocked.
He was one of my favorites. He had a real personality, which is what a lot of the guys I don't think have these days.
We're missing that together.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you're right. We're missing some of these people do lack personality, and people gave Mr. Olympia Phil Heath a little bit of grief for that. But that was because he was kind of just trying to become the best ever. And now that he's not really training like for Mr. Olympia, he's opened up a little bit, and a lot of people seem to really enjoy Phil Heath now. And do you think that that's what it is? These people are just so focused. I mean, Jay Cutler's. I mean, he's the exception to the rule, and I see people bothering him during workouts and stuff, and he stops and shakes their hand. But I could see people getting angry when people walk up, sir, can I get your autograph? Can I take a picture with you? You must have dealt with a ton of that at Gold's in Venice, correct?
Correct. Well, and that's why I admire Arnold so much. I mean, he would be, he would understand that these are the fans that made him. And it was amazing how much, he would stop and take pictures and talk to people. I mean, he's still doing it today. He's still down training at Gold's Gym Venice occasionally with his son.
Yep.
And I think it's only actually Gold's Gym Venice is only there because he's kept Google at bay. Google owns the building, wants to expand their campus. So Arnold has, really been loyal to Gold's Gym his whole life.
Yeah, and I'll tell you, that's fantastic having loyalty like that. I mean, who'd have thought that you know, years back, a $15,000 investment. You passed on the BMW. We'll turn it into what it did. And I mean, what an amazing ride it's been so far. I mean, now you're an author. So, I mean, now we got the book and now this is a new door that opens and there's also new things you're working on. Guys, we got to do this. We're going to take a brief break. We come back. We got another one last segment with Ed. We're going to smash this out. We're having a great time. Anybody who has questions, throw them up in the chat room because we're coming back right after this very, very brief message, guys. I appreciate it. We'll see you right after this.
Hey guys, tonight's episode of the Happy Hour is brought to you by Chili Sleep Technology. Chili Sleep Systems is a game changer. Chili's Cool Mesh Pad is the most luxurious sleep system in the industry and is also hydro-powered. This can warm you up on those cold winter evenings or cool you off during a steamy summer night. Promo code KINGHAP will save you 22% off an entire sleep system. This is certainly a purchase that you will not regret. Our systems can bring the temperature anywhere from 55 degrees to 115 by remote control or the Chili Sleep app. Get over to chilitechnology.com and make sure to use promo code KINGHAP to save 22%. And now, back to a man that needs absolutely no help warming it up in between the sheets, your host of the Happy Hour, King Hap.
Oh, yeah. I'll tell you, it doesn't take the man who started the franchise of Gold's Gym to tell you one of the best things you can do for your own personal fitness is make sure you get proper rest. Guys, chilisleep.com, promo code KINGHAP, save 30%. Yes, 30%. Wow. Ed, we're back, and I'll tell you, my man, you're honestly, everybody in the chat room loves you, and I mean, you seem like you're having a great time. I mean, you tell me, what's on your mind, big man? How the hell are you, and how's everything treating you? And you tell me, is there anything else going on that you need to throw out there?
Actually, your message during the break interests me because I should have put that in my book, but one of the biggest issues I saw with bodybuilders that, you know, when they stay in your house, you kind of see pluses and minuses, most of them did not get enough sleep. So getting, you know, 8 hours, I think is very important, and getting, you know, power naps during the day, if you can.
Yep.
Probably no bodybuilder slept more than in my house than either Jay Cutler or Lee Priest, you know, two of the greatest.
Yep.
So definitely sleep is important. And I don't think, you know, put your phone away, turn it off. Don't sleep with your phone.
And, you know, I'm guilty of that, too, is it doesn't give you a good night's sleep. I mean, and I'm not saying it because they're a great spot. I mean, one of the greatest sponsors and one of the people that help keep us on the air, Chili Sleep. I mean, having the great temperature, setting your room, you know, room darkening shades, et cetera. Yeah. There's big things you can do to adjust so you can get a good night's sleep. One of those is put the phone away and you know, basically keep that thing away from you. Because I can tell you, I get notifications all night long. And I shouldn't even keep that thing anywhere near me. My question that I got for you though, right? So I've you know, had a lot of them. What would you say if you had, like, we got the book here. If you had to give a teaser for the book, one of your favorite parts, I mean, obviously this is all about your life. So in this book, what would you say is your favorite portion? Because what people don't understand, if you haven't read this book yet, this has all different parts to it. And I mean, you can basically flip through and there's, I mean, you don't even have to, I don't suggest it, but you don't even have to read this book in order because it's almost like there's like 10 small books inside here. What's your favorite part of this? And what do you think if you were going to tell people to go ahead and buy this book, what portion would you say is one to buy it for?
Well, that's a very good question. Well, first off, I think if you're in the fitness industry, you need to understand its history.
Yep.
I don't think people realize how the gyms have changed over the past 45 years. And, you know, I'm an architect, so I focus a lot on square footages. So that's something anybody in the industry needs to understand. Also, the personal training business, how that started and how to approach that. But then, of course, the individual stories, you know, were a lot of fun. Like, you know, I think Lee Priest stayed in my house for 5 months and he was there with a couple of other house guests, actually, you know, three or four during the that period. So that's a kind of a funny chapter. And people have told me exactly what you said. They could pick the book up at different points and start reading and enjoy it, the chapter on its own. But Lee was stranded in Venice, and I offered him a place to stay, but he shared back in the day, you know, you call it a Jack and Jill bedroom where they share a bath. And I had a 19-year-old high school kid that was trying to get big for college on the other side. And he was so intimidated by Lee that when Lee locked his side of the bathroom door, he never bothered to use the bathroom for the 5 months Lee was there. And so he used the toilet off the kitchen and he showered at the gym. But that's kind of a funny story. But there were many little, you know, run-ins like that with the house guests. My house was kind of a guru house because there were usually, you know, two or three guys there at any one time. So they learned from each other. And it's funny, the interaction that occurred, you know, with people that all had the similar vision. This is the first time probably they were with anybody that had a similar goal, right? They were, for most of them, it was the first time on a plane.
Yep. There were oddballs where they came from. I mean, people that were especially people that were considered like mass monsters. I mean, you were the exception and not the rule back then. I mean, correct?
Right. They were with other freaks for the first time in their life, but especially the European body, like Gunther. I mean, he was a freak in Germany. I mean, the Germans want you all to kind of be alike, look alike. And so he was really, you know, his whole look was frowned on. And that's why, you know, I mean, that's why so many, and starting with Arnold, I mean, he came over here and, you know, he had a whole new life. Dennis Wolfe, I brought to America in 2004. I ran into him at Flex Lewis's gym opening in Las Vegas, Dragon's Lair last year. And I said, you know, I was happy to see he'd become an American citizen. And I said, Dennis, why did you become an American? He said, well, any country that you can get a driver's license for $35 after a short test, you gotta love. You know, because in Germany, it costs $1,000 and takes about a year.
So that's funny, I'll tell you. And you know, you think about it too, right? I mean, Big Bad Wolf, he had a hell of a career. I mean, cut short, unfortunately. I actually spoke with him at the Mr. Olympia, I think it was 3 years ago. Mm-hmm. I seen him. And he was, you know, he was walking kind of, he looked like he was in some pain. But hey, good to see him back lifting. I see him on social media. He looks great again. I mean, he doesn't look like the Big Bad Wolf, but he looks great again. Thank God for his continued health. But I mean, some of these guys, man, you'd think that they, you know, you look at somebody like Dennis Wolfe and you think this guy has to be an asshole, right? I mean, he's big, he's scary looking. Quite the contrary. I mean, my goodness, some of these bodybuilders are the great, like I said, Cedric McMillan, I didn't know from a hole in the wall. I walked away like, but I felt like I was going to, you know, go meet him for a beer later. The guy was so cool. Yeah. It's like, these people are great people. They just got these genetics and hey, they are big. I mean, you must agree with that one as well, right?
Completely. Well, you picked up a theme in my book is these guys wanted to be real life superheroes and superheroes aren't bad guys. They wanted to be, you know, many of them got into law enforcement or joined the military after 2001 or became firemen. That was a common, you know, occupation of former house guests that didn't go, you know, full bore into bodybuilding. They wanted to be superheroes to people.
Yep.
Huge influence.
And, you know, I'll tell you what, seeing these people, the magazines, everything, this got people working out. I mean, I can tell you what, that's the reason I started working out, and I still love it to this day. I got this, you know, ankle gates going on here. I mean, we got the busted ankle trying to come back from. But, I mean, I miss, you know, I can't work out every day except right now till I heal up a little bit. But it's something I miss when I can't do it. It's actually therapeutic. And I mean, you must have found it therapeutic, as does a lot of the, you know, bodybuilders, right? I mean, this
I'm still trying to get 10 to 20,000 steps in a day and swim. And no, you gotta stay active. And these guys inspired a lot of people to work out. And it's wonderful. I mean, that's the whole point in my book is that Joe Weider's magazines and the other fitness magazines, along with Gold's Gym and Arnold, changed the culture regarding working out and fitness.
Yes. Yes. It made the people that love to work out, we weren't freaks anymore. You know what I mean?
Right. Yeah.
Good question come from the chat room. I got to throw this your way. I mean, people want to know what you think of the youth of today, where they're staying in, playing video games, playing on their phones. They're not outside and active. I mean, you yourself, you must think that's terrible. I know I do. And I encourage everybody to play sports and lift weights, etc. That's a terrible thing. Yeah. And do you have any ideas? Like, I mean, you say that you're working on the new post-pandemic gym. You have any ideas in your head where we can get people up and doing stuff again?
Well, exactly. That's what I've been working on. Actually, I started 10 years ago before the pandemic, because I realized that the people that made Gold's Gym the famous and the Mecca no longer exist in any number. You are different. You are not like today's millennial. Yep. So I saw virtual training in use when I was in Germany 10 years ago at a McFit gym. Now he's the owner of Gold's Gym, the Reiner Schaller. So I've been working on a gym that uses technology to entertain, to educate a person working out and entertain them to get results. So I have a gym that's basically relies on virtual training and virtual reality. I'm working with Ryan DeLuca, who used to own bodybuilding.com, who's developed Black Box VR, where you put on a headset and you get a workout in a resistance machine. And you wouldn't need to know how to do anything to do this workout. And in all three major rooms in my model, cardio, stretching, yoga, and strength, you would not need to know how to do anything. There's 70, 80% of Americans don't know what to do in a gym.
So and that's one of the things that keeps them out, right? I mean, people go, you walk into a Gold's Gym and you see freaking Arnold Schwarzenegger over here. And you're because I'll tell you, when I first started working out, that was one of the things that scared me. I walked into this private gym and, like you said, chalk and, you know, people basically sweating, smelling wild rock music. I'll tell you what, I got some of the best workouts of my life there. But it's intimidating to walk through those doors. And that's what Gold's Gym pretty much tried to put to sleep, right? I mean, that was kind of...
We wanted to be fitness for everybody. That was our motto. And my goal was to be sort of McDonald's of fitness, where there were so many that when you thought of workout, you thought of Gold's Gym. So it was not intimidating. And unfortunately, the owners that bought in 04 lost a lot of great operators. So actually it became more of a boutique gym for big guys.
Yeah.
Was intimidating. So their fear became reality because of the way they treated our gym owners.
And you just threw me a softball that I gotta crush this one, because I'll tell you something I took away from your book, and I just wanted to double check with you, is that originally there was a group of people, of investors, that wanted to buy Gold's Gym. Is this correct? And that included Tony Robbins. And I mean, is that accurate? And Tony Robbins, I mean, businessman extraordinaire, and I mean, motivation 101. If you know what I mean, that would have been a fantastic buyer for Gold's Gym.
He was one of 17 buyers in 04. I didn't have a vote in the matter, but he would have been my choice, because I've always been interested in that mind-body connection. And actually, I've been talking to him about my new prototype. He's very interested.
And that's if you get Tony Robbins to tell you that it's a go, I mean, he's somebody, I mean, God, he has zillions of followers, you know what I mean? And I'll tell you, he earns them too, because I'll tell you what, I listen to him, I get up, I got a broken friggin' hoof, I want to get up and start shadow boxing, I hear that guy talk, you know what I mean? He's pretty intense, and if he had purchased Gold's Gym, what do you think Gold's Gym would probably look like today?
It would look a lot, well, there would certainly be a lot more of them. It would be a whole different animal, yeah.
I agree. I'll tell you guys, I'm having so much fun. And, you know, Ed's been saying, he's been so just basically so goddamn generous with his time. And I appreciate it. What we're going to do, I mean, hey, I'd love to keep him here all night. I could talk to you, Ed, all night long. But I'll tell you, it's that time of the night, guys. It's last call. Don't you go nowhere, because it ain't over. But last call is being brought to you by Clearwater Distillery. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, clearwaterdistillery.com. Promo code KINGHAP. Save yourself 10%. And if you get $120 worth of items, we'll even ship them to you for free. It is the most delicious small batch alcohol on planet Earth today. And it is the official top shelf alcohol, the Happy Hour Social Club. Clearwaterdistilling.com. Promo code KINGHAP. Save yourself 10% site wide. I'll tell you what, Ed, it's last call. So I gotta ask you, right? Two things. Do you have anything else for the Happy Hour Social Club members? And if they want to, where can they find you on social media?
They can find me on social media at www.edconnors.com. I'm on Instagram as Jim Architect, G-Y-M. And I'm on Facebook as Edward Connors.
And guys, that'll all be in the show notes. And I mean, hey, the guys, you want them to, any special spot you want them to grab the book? Because I know we've been posting the Amazon link. I mean, Amazon.com for the book.
They can also buy it on at Barnes & Noble website and get it shipped to them. And I'd love for anyone who reads it to do a review.
Absolutely.
Amazon or Barnes & Noble. So appreciate that very much.
BarnesandNoble.com, guys. You guys, make sure get over there and leave a review. I'm finishing my book. I mean, hey, you know what's funny is I polished this off today, Ed. There's some of the things I want to go back over, though, because there's so much good information in this, guys. I'm going to make sure I leave my review over on Barnes & Noble, guys. Make sure you do it. The link will be in the show notes as well to go ahead and get you over there. Guys, I just want to say time is so precious. As we talked about some people that die prematurely, etc. I just want to say time is precious. I appreciate you spending some with me. I mean, time is one thing that, you know, nobody can give you or money cannot buy. So thank you so much for hanging out with us here in the happy hour. And Ed, I appreciate you taking the time to come on here and speak with me and the happy hour social club members. Everybody is having a blast. Thank you so much for coming on, big man.
I really enjoyed it, and I'm so impressed that you read my book and your questions were great.
I appreciate that. And you know what? I mean, hey, this is a great book, and it's one of those page turners. You start turning them, you don't want to stop. So do me a favor, Ed. I mean, be proud of this book because this is awesome. And I mean, it sings right to me. I'm a fitness enthusiast. So thank you again.
You're very welcome.
Guys, what we're going to do, we're going to kick it out of here in 1 second with the Abyss, but I want to thank everybody. We'll be back live Wednesday and Thursday night here on the happyhoursocialclub.com, Happy Hour SC on Twitch TV. And should you guys want to get any swag, we sent out 17 packages of swag last week. Thank you so much. Happy Hour Social Club on Instagram, Happy Hour Social Club on Facebook, happyhoursocialclub.com, guys. I love you so much. Do me a favor. We're going to kick it out of here. I'm going to leave you with Abyss version 1. Good night, ladies and gentlemen. I love you so much. We will see you back real soon. Talk to you soon, everybody.
Yeah. Abyss. AbyssHipHop.com. Happy hour.
It's the happy hour. It's a short shot. Miss Spud getting on your sports talk. Yeah. Stats at the buzzer. Whatever sport, no happy. But it's the happy hour. Hear the highlights. He's in the game while the others on the sidelines. It's his buzz that gets. Hap's a pro, but he covers it best. It's nothing but net. Nah. Hear the cheers from the stands. And when we need a ticket, we call out a Joe the ticket man. Yeah. Walking to arenas with an entourage. Don't let us catch you up in our seats again. Cause you're dealing with some sports fans. What am I gonna do? Drop it out like a floor plan? Man. Never question the roster. Strength is essential from these hand-picked monsters. So, don't sleep, take a no-nose. He's got the word on the street from chokeholds to Pro Bowls. So, where you going for your sports talk right here? Got it on lock, so snap your door, stop.
Anthony and Mike, thank you very much. It was really great.